Good morning, everybody. It's good to be back. Hopefully I look a little more tanned than when I left. Thank you so much for your prayers, and I'm sure God is going to be glorified through what's going to happen through the funeral. And Debbie's grandmother was a believer, and so we go with a sense of comfort into this season. So thank you for your prayers, though. I'm sure Debbie appreciates it, and I know I appreciate it a lot as well. We're going to be speaking this morning more about promises, and we have a promise this morning that is, for me personally, one of the most glorifying, God-honoring, wonderful things that God gave to me in my whole life. There's a story about Mozart that you never know if they're true or not, because, you know, he lived so long ago, but I hope this one's true. The story goes that when he was a young adult but still living with his father, he would go out late at nights with his friends, and then he would come home way after his father had gone to sleep, and he would play a prank on his father sometimes. He would get to the house, and he would sit down on the piano that they had there super late at night, and he would start playing a piece. And he would play it louder and more passionately, you know, all building and building and building, up until he got to the end, and just before the end, he would stop without playing the last note. He would not play the last note. And he would close the piano, and he would get up, and he would go to bed. And because he played so loudly, obviously it would wake up his father. And his father was a very accomplished pianist himself. And so his father would be able to hear what's going on, and he would not be able to fall asleep again. He would toss and turn, and he, until he had got up and walked over that piano and, bunk, played the last key. And then he felt he could go back to sleep again. I hope his father got him back in some way and returned the favor. I share that story because there is a sense in which God has done something similar in the world. God has begun a song, a beautiful, wonderful song, and he has begun it in creation. It has reached a beautiful character and taken shape in Christ. And now he has given it to us, in a sense, unfinished. Though he promises he will finish it and Christ will return and this song will come to an end, but for now, we get to play the song. We get to be part of the next notes that are played in this song. And God is using us in such a way to continue this melody throughout in the world today. It is a song of redemption. It is a song that tells of God's glory in this world, and it is our honor and our privilege that we get to be a part of it. We have the opportunity, we are invited to participate in God, with God in his unfolding story. And that forms a promise in our life. It forms a promise that we have significance, that what we do matters, that what we do truly counts. We can see this throughout the whole of the New Testament and the Old Testament. And I want to point one verse today, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, where we see this promise being spoken of. If you turn there with me, Ephesians chapter 2, we'll start in verse 9, in verse 9. Ephesians 2, verse 9 and 10. No, we'll start at verse 8. It's better. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. Here's the promise. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Now, who does this promise apply to? This promise that God has prepared for us good works, that he has given for us things to do, things to accomplish, things to walk in, things that matter. This promise applies to every Christian across the board. Those who feel they are too young to really have stepped into their own yet and are waiting for that day. No, right now there are things for you to do. Those who are too old in their own eyes and think that life has now passed them by and they're beyond their prime and they don't really have much to offer. No, 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 you have good works to do that God has prepared for you beforehand that you might walk in them. Those who feel that they have no marketable skills, that the world doesn't really value anything that they possess and feel downtrodden and looked aside. This applies to you too. Those who feel they are meek and shy and hate the spotlight, it applies to you too. All Christians, they have this significance to their lives. They have the promise that they can be part of something that is of eternal value, that it will never end. And that word that we see there being spoken of in verse 10, where it says, we are his workmanship. That word is an artistic word. It means a poema is the Greek word that is used. It speaks of a poem or a song that God is writing and that we are that. We are the poem. We are the song that God is creating. God is composing our life. He is composing us as we continue forward and being able to do good works for his life, for his name. And this means that our lives have developed a deep significance, a significance that without him, there's absolutely no way we could have. The promise that our actions have eternal significance, that what you do will not fade away, that the impact that you make will really echo into eternity, because it's part of this larger story that God is telling. It's part of this unfolding song that God is playing. This promise means that even the ordinary of your life can become extraordinary. This is one of the greatest things that I received from God when I became a Christian. When I look at all the gifts that God has given me, this gift of significance, this gift of purpose and promise, as one that has more impact on my life, has had a more tangible feeling of joy that has come from it and satisfaction that has been born out of it than perhaps any other gift that I have experienced that God has given me. Before becoming a Christian, the great fear that I had was that my life was extremely insignificant. I was a nobody. I felt like I could make no change, that I had no ability to make any real lasting change within myself or within the world around me. And though I didn't recognize it at the time, what I was feeling then was my own poverty, my own truly bankrupt nature within me. Brian Fickett, who works a lot with the poor, and he wrote an excellent book called Helping Without Hurting. It's a fantastic book. I suggest you read it if you can. He says that when we who are more affluent try to describe what poverty is, we usually think of it in terms of material poverty, like they lack things. But he says if you ask a person who is poor what it means to be poor, they describe it in radically different terms. And one of the things that they use to describe what it means to be poor is a lack of ability to make any lasting or significant change in their lives or in the world around them. That's what it feels like to be poor. And what I was recognizing before becoming a Christian was my own poverty, my own bankrupt nature, that I could not affect any change, that nothing I did was of any significance whatsoever. And what God has given me, this sense of purpose, this sense of significance, has been so profoundly impactful in my life. It has radically changed the way I deal with myself, the way I deal with the world around me. And this is more than simply enrichment. I'm not speaking that my life beforehand was fine, but now it's better. No, this is salvation. This is rescue. When you look at the whole of Ephesians chapter 2 from verse 1 to 10, you see that it makes a contrast between the way that we were and the way that we are. And there are multiple levels to which this passage is speaking of, the deepest of which is salvation, but it also speaks about the way that we live our lives now and what we can hope to achieve in our lives in the days to come. And look at the state of ourselves, our spiritual state prior to meeting Christ. You look in Ephesians chapter 2 and it uses words like dead. We were dead, completely gone. We were following the world in its disobedience. We were living out of the passions of our flesh and body and mind. In other words, we couldn't follow anything higher. We were dead. We were walking in the way of disobedience. All of that we were going to achieve was futile, following no greater or higher path than simply our own desires, our own passions, our own mind of what we think is right and wrong and what we desire in that moment. I feel like I want to eat, so I eat. I feel like I want to have sex, so I have sex. And that's it. That's all we could do. But God, that wonderful, strong, beautiful conjunction, the most beautiful conjunction in all the world, but God. Beforehand, we were dead. Now, we are alive by His grace. Beforehand, we had nothing that we could achieve of any significance. Simply following our own passions, simply walking away from God in disobedience, dead. Now, created for good works. Now, living out of God's desires. Now, able to make significant impact in the world around us. Not to say that people who are not Christian can do no good without God. Of course they can do good. Yet, without God, until you receive God and are made alive with Him, all that you're doing will fade away. Until you align yourself with what God is doing in this world, until you walk in step with what He is purposing in this world, you will fade away as your works will fade away. Nothing is going to last except for His kingdom. And all glory given to all other things will fade away except for the glory given to God. And that is why we are now living lives that have significant value. And that is why we contain the promise within us that we can make a difference. We can do something that will last in this world because it will not fade away. God's kingdom will not fade away. God's glory will not fade away. And this that we have been given, this new life that we have now, is a gift. We have been rescued from meaninglessness. We have been rescued from frustration and destruction. Now placed in a way that God is going to maintain what we do for all time. We must grasp this as a gift. We must realize the depth of what God has done and given to us. Luke chapter 7, verse 36 to 50. We don't have time to read it, but I really suggest you do because it teaches us vividly what happens to those who do not realize the gift that God has given them. But that those who do, those who really understand what it is that God has done in their heart, the depth of the gift that He has given to us, they become alive with love for God. They become able and willing to serve Him and obey Him. They step out of spiritual weakness and death into life and vivid connection with God. The one that grasps all that God has done for them is eager to serve Him. And that is what I encourage for you this morning, my friends. Grasp all that God has done for you. Grasp all that God has given you in your new life that you have now. And this passage makes two things clear. Two things that we often in our selfish nature, our individualistic tendencies, have to come to terms with, and it can be difficult. Now that we are saved, two things are true of us. One, we are His. We are His. We belong to Him. You never didn't belong to God, but now you just realize it. And now it is your duty to give your allegiance over to Him. You owe allegiance to God. You owe your life to Him. And my friends, no one has done more to earn that. And the second thing we learn is that we are His workmanship. We are His craft, His poem. In other words, God desires to do things through us. God desires to tell a story through us, to accomplish things through us. And that means we must be active. We must be doing things. We must be productive, just like our Father is productive. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 11 speaks of this as well. I'm in the wrong passage. Whoever speaks, speak as one who speaks the oracles of God. Whoever serves, serve as one by whoever serves as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God might be glorified through Jesus Christ. To Him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. This means that our lives, when we live in such a way, have the ability to give glory to God. And that is exactly what we are called to do. We are called to live in such a way that God is glorified. We speak as one who speaks the words of God. We labor as one who labors with the strength of God so that he might be glorified. Do you realize the privilege that you have been given? That your life can reflect the glory of your Maker. That your life has the opportunity to show the world around you how beautiful God is. What a privilege that is. The promise that our lives have, the promise of eternal value, the promise that our actions can go towards something bigger that will last forever and give glory to the one who shines with more glory than anything else in this world. But this promise comes with a condition. You are not the star of the show. God is. Your life is to give him glory. We live in such a way to glorify him. Our goals should not reflect our desires, our comfort, our prosperity, our achievements. They should reflect his character, his plan, his desires, his advancement, the advancement of his kingdom. And to that end, and that end alone, we participate. We cannot take this privilege to be able to work it into our own advantage, but only we are privileged to participate in the way that it gives glory unto God. But when you do that, everything is redeemed about your life. Your life becomes an adventure. Life with God, truly, it is an adventure. In big ways, we see this because God will constantly be challenging you, challenging what you define as love, challenging what you define as strength, being able to work more and more within you, surprising you with what you can achieve when you work alongside with him, bringing you into places, equipping you to serve within your Christian community, within the wider community, to sow the seeds of the gospel, to water them, to see growth and tend to what God is doing in this world. God has taken me to some incredibly amazing places, not around the world, but in this city, in my own heart, in the lives of other people. I've been privileged to people to open up in trust so that God might be glorified, so that he might be praised in this world. There is so much to do, my friends. So much to do in this world. When you look at how big the world is and how big what it is that God is trying to accomplish in this world, I promise you, invest your heart and your strength in the kingdom of God and you will never be bored. You will always, always have something to do. If you want to see God be glorified and his kingdom come in this world, you will never be bored. Even in the small things. The small things like riding on the metro or sitting down at the end of a day, these things have the kinetic energy to be something incredible. Your metro ride, you might have the opportunity to talk to someone and share the gospel with them or to bless someone with the love of Christ. Your job is not simply something you do to earn money, but it is the field of opportunity that you have to bear witness to the glorious character of God and to promote righteousness and right living in this world. Your family isn't simply those who you live with, but they are the partners with you in Christian growth and in glorifying God through the goals that you set together. Your quiet moments, you can take up that mantle of prayer and pray for all those people in your life, which is so, so important. You know what some of the greatest moments of my day is? When I brush my teeth, because I look in the mirror and I have that opportunity, it just reminds me to think of all that God has given me, all the great reasons I have to show gratitude to him and to thank him for all he has done, to nourish my soul with the Lord in that moment, ready to meet the day ahead of me with the strength that God provides. Just by brushing your teeth, using that moment of quietness in your life, it can become something incredible if you allow it to. John Piper says this: nothing gives more encouragement for daily life than to know the purposes of God in the world and to feel your heart warmly in tune with them. I think that's absolutely true, and I can testify it of my own life. 2017 could be to you as well the year that no longer you labor for things that are temporary, the vapors of this world that will fade away, but to turn your hand and your heart towards the eternal things, towards the God glorifying things in this world. To ask the question, what is God doing in this world? And how can I bring my heart in line with it? What are the goals that God would have for my life, for my time on earth, my sphere of influence that I have around me? What would God have me do now, today? And to be able to ask that continuously throughout this year and throughout the rest of your life. The lead singer of U2, Bono, I don't know much about him, but I know this, that he is attributed to saying this, that a turning point in his life was when he used to pray that God would bless him and bless all that he was doing. And yet one day he stopped praying that. He said he stopped asking God to bless what he was doing. Instead, he asked, "What God, what are you doing in this world?" And then he began to do that as well, because he knew that that was already blessed. That what God was doing in the world was already blessed. And if he wanted to live a life that was blessed, then he should do what God is doing, because it's already blessed. I think that's a wonderful idea. And if we do that, our daily life, our daily walk is already set before us. As the passage says, there are good works that God has prepared for us to do, that we might walk in them. The Lord has laid down opportunities for you right now, today, and in the future to come. He has given you the opportunity, and he has pre-supplied his power for you to be able to do these things. And it's in your life, and uniquely in your life too. Things that you can do that other Christians cannot do. Things that if you don't do, God will not be glorified in your life in a way that he could otherwise have been. Glorified in this world. And my friends, count it as a privilege. You are privileged to be able to do this. We have been saved from meaninglessness. We have been saved from despair and have been given our remaining days as a gift to do something meaningful with the time that we have here. We are called to live lives of hope. And what is hope? Hope is investing your time, your energy, your passion, your security, something that is valuable to you, some valuable part of yourself, into a goal or an idea, believing that it will come to pass. Hope is those who do not take the world as it is, but wish for a better world and fight for it, who agonize for holiness, who agonize for God to be glorified in this world. Those hopeful people are those who work in the present with an eye towards the future. Hope are those who do not settle for the way things are, but labor for the way that they could and should be. Hopeful people are those who say, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Those are people who are hopeful, who labor until they are breathless, knowing that all that we do in this world is not done in vain if we do it for the glory of God and for the advancement of his kingdom. There is a man I met once who epitomized this idea of hopefulness and laboring for good. I perhaps have told you about him before, but his name is Rob Kane. He is a man I met quite by accident, but who had a profound impact on my life. He was a youth pastor until he was 65 years old. And then, you can imagine the amount of energy it takes. And then, when he retired at 65, he moved from Australia to China to become a missionary in China. When he was 65, he began to learn Mandarin so that he could serve as a missionary. What an incredible man. What an incredible passion for God that this man had. What an incredible sense of work ethic that he had for the kingdom. And I asked him, I managed to spend a week with him while I was in China, and I asked him, "How do you choose the right people to serve with you in your team? You know, you have to have the right team around you in ministry." And I said, "What's your advice to choosing the right people for your team?" And he said, "Chris, it's easier to install a steering wheel than it is to install an engine." I was like, okay. What he meant by that, he says, don't look for people who are talented. Look for people who want to make a difference. He says, you might have all the things you need in a person, but if they don't have that drive, if they don't have that energy, that passion, that get up and go for God, then you're not going to be able to supply that. He said, you can teach someone how to lead a Bible study. You can teach them how to organize a program, how to lead groups, how to prepare meals and serve the homeless. But you cannot teach them how to have a fire in their soul for the glory of the Lord to shine. That's something that God supplies to them. And if they don't have that, then they got to go back and get it. That's absolutely true. It's much easier to install a steering wheel than it is to install an engine. That passion that comes from within. It comes from God. It comes, though, when we decide to no longer settle for everyday life, but instead realize and grasp hold of the promise that the Christian life is an adventure. That it is something that is going to be incredibly exciting. That God is going to do amazing things through us. We live with a sense of hope about all that God is going to accomplish for His glory and His kingdom through the time that He has given us on earth. John Ortberg says this, hope is the fuel that our hearts run on. Right now, we do not know how God is going to take our lives and use them. How God is going to use our prayers, our service, art, writing, political actions, music, honesty, patience, day-to-day labor, mercy, teaching, outreach, encouragements, ideas, sacrifice, love, and weave them all into the song that He is playing, the song of redemption and glory that echoes out into all the world around us. But we know that He is. He will do it. He will take all that we have done for His glory, and He will use it, and it will last forever and ever. So follow the promise of God, that your life may bear fruit for His glory. Invest and strive and hope, because God is looking for those people who will play the next notes of His song. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank You so much for the promise that You have given us, that our lives bear weight, that they bear significance. And I pray, Lord, that what would happen today would serve to advance Your kingdom and glorify You in this world. That, Lord, all that we do today will be done for Your glory. And I pray, Lord, that as we continue to step into this new year, we will do so with a sense of hope, not accepting things as they are, but seeking to glorify You. And we pray, Lord, may Your kingdom come. May Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, will you please rise together? We thank You so much for being with us today and for having patience as we continue to renovate everything. But I pray that God would bless you as you go out this day, that as you go out into this week, that the Father would be with you, encouraging you and teaching you, that Jesus Christ would be your guide, would be the one that you chase after in this world, and that the Holy Spirit would provide the energy and the passion that you need to get through these weeks. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.